I think it's recorded now. For the sake of those who are not in class today, this morning, and who would like to hear the recording, I again, we are just reviewing right now what we've done in this class, starting with the fields that we have seen, because this is a class for electrostatic fields and electromagnetic, so it focuses on the field. But we said the field is the result of a force, and the force is the result of a source. So the force is here, so its electrostatic field is due to, and force, electrostatic force. Or electric force. Okay. Then the sources are static charges, charges that do not move. Then the result was a circuit element, which we created that concept. We lumped the effect of an electrostatic field, and we created a circuit element we call capacitance. And what a capacitance does is to store this electrostatic field. So out of an electrostatic field, we created a circuit element. Magnetostatic is a field that is created by magnetic forces. Magnetic forces are created by charges that are moving with a constant velocity, and the circuit element that we produced out of this magnetic field was an inductance, or an inductor, inductance. Inductance is the concept, inductor is the element. And then, so here, to be accurate, I will say capacitor as a circuit element. And then here, I will say inductor. All right, so this is a circuit element. Something else which we spoke about, but we did not spend that much time, and eventually if you go to a higher class in these topics, you're gonna talk about it, are losses in these two systems. And losses in electrostatics come from, so when you have a charge that is not moving and is creating an electrostatic field, then other charges, like electrons, if you have a positive charge, other charges in the neighborhood or in the space where these electric forces are exerted because of the initial static charges, are gonna start moving under the influence of this electric force. And while they're moving, and they move within a space that has other atoms, it has other electrons, it has a crystal structure, and then there are other ions that are in specific positions, then there will be electron is going to hit all of these other electrons. They are going to hit each other, and then when they do that, they change direction. That's one thing, but also they're losing energy. So every time there is something like that, an electron is scattered off by another electron because they hit each other, or by a crystal structure, or by another ion, and changes direction, it loses energy, and this energy changes into heat. That happens always in real materials, all right? Only in free space, which is like a made up material, we are using it because there's no free space unless you go to vacuum in deep space. But here on Earth, even in atmosphere, we have losses. They may be very small, so may not take them into account, but there are losses. So always, because of these forces and because other charges will move under the influence of these forces, we have losses. And those losses here are expressed in the form of a circuit element as resistors. So always, both in the electrostatic case as well as in the magnetostatic case, we have not only capacitors, but we also have resistors. And these resistors are important because they take care of this very important phenomena that shows why devices that operate under electrostatic fields or magnetostatic or electromagnetics, why they heat up. Why is it your cell phone, if you operate it for a long time, starts warming up? Why is it your computer, when you operate it for a long time, is heating up? And as a matter of fact, they have a whole very advanced system to cool it down, because obviously there are losses everywhere, and those losses translate into heat. So we have resistors in every circuit. And the same thing applies to the magnetostatic cases. So you have resistors here because of magnetic losses. Okay? And even if we have not spent enough time to describe how we're gonna calculate those, but we spend more time talking about the capacitors and the inductors. So then, using resistors, capacitors, and inductors, we moved from electrostatic and magnetostatic fields to electromagnetic fields. And so we went to time-varying fields, first of all. In time-varying fields, what is different from the electrostatic and magnetostatic case is we have both electric and magnetic fields, and those are connected. So time varying, which are classified as time varying fields. And of course we have time varying forces, all right? Forces and fields. These are the fields which are generated when what happens? When charges move with varying velocity. So in other words, they have acceleration with time varying velocities. And why are those related? Because we found that if you have a charge that is moving, but they like a current that is, it's a moving charge, obviously, or many charges moving, many electrons moving with a constant velocity make a steady current. But when either the current changes with time or the flux of this current changes with time over an area, the circuits in that area where the flux changes with time are feeling the impact of those charges, of those fields, currents, and then you have the generation of an electric field. So out of a magnetic field that is changing its flux or is changing itself, you have a generated electric current, or you have a generated electric field via the concept of the EMF, the electromagnetic force, and which translates into voltage. And we've seen those, all right? So we have static charges that are not moving, electrostatic fields. Charges that are moving with a constant velocity, magnetostatic fields. And charges that move with time-varying velocities, like have an acceleration, then they create both an electric and magnetic field, which are interconnected. And in this case, we have, obviously, both capacitors due to the presence of the electric field, inductors due to the presence of the magnetic field, and of course, resistors for the losses. Okay, so this is what we found. Now, having the time-varying forces and fields and the electromagnetic, if we call effect, we went from here to transmission lines, because transmission lines, the forces vary with time, and or the sources vary with time. So the charges in transmission lines create sources, and then we see them usually in circuit, in a circuit environment. The sources, the source is going to be what? Excuse me. The source is going to be a voltage. So in this case, we have voltages that change with time. What does that really mean? It means that we have charges that have acceleration, and as a matter of fact, a voltage that changes with time implies that it's going to create an electric field and a magnetic field. An electric field, obviously, is going to express in a voltage V of T, and a magnetic field in a current I of T when you go to circuits, all right? So that's how we went from the time-varying forces and fields to transmission lines, and then specifically we talked about ideal transmission lines. And in ideal transmission lines, which is a very useful and simple concept, we used capacitors, inductors, and resistors to be able to find how the currents and voltages propagate on these lines. And we said that this concept of ideal transmission lines is very useful in digital circuits. Digital circuits. And then we said that all of the other concepts from this down, so this one, and this one, were very useful in very low frequencies, which practically we can find. So low, it's always a relative term, does not mean zero, but it could be that in low frequencies, the wavelengths are very high. So, and some of the circuits we design are very, very small compared to the wavelength. So all of these, three cases that I have highlighted here led us to transmission lines, which is an approximation that we use very effectively in many applications, in digital circuits, but also in analog circuits, when the dimensions are very small compared to the wavelength. So this is a summary of what we've done in this class. So we built the pyramid up. So we went from here, there, there, there. So the question is, where do we go from here? So So if you think we have developed some fundamental theories that help us, not quite, but enough with the understanding of circuits. Okay, so we talked a little bit about some filters, microstrips, and of course lumped elements. And these are fundamental blocks to, not everything, but fundamental blocks to build a real system. And you can put many other things there, which of course you need some additional theories to understand them, but this is really a good foundation to consider, for example, a receiver, how a receiver is built. All right, so you can say in this class, I've learned some elements that we can use in building a receiver. Now, what are other important things in our a transmitter, say? What other important things in this category of problems? So if you are in the communications world, and usually in communications, if you have two cell phones, when I call you, or when I started Zoom this morning, a signal with my voice and my video image went through a transmitter to an antenna. This antenna went practically up to a satellite here. And then it went down to another antenna. And then it went from here to a receiver. Here to the receiver. And then it went from there to you. So this is me. And there it's you. You can argue that what we've done in class, it has helped us with this, and it has helped us with that, with these two circuits. But we have learned nothing about this one, which is the antenna, and more importantly, about these waves. The waves that effectively connect us. Because at the end, even if we have the fundamentals about these two systems, the transmitter and the receiver, we have learned nothing about they communicate with free space. If that communication were not there, then practically we would not have the opportunity to have a Zoom class this morning. So now what we would like to do in this class is to learn about the waves, and that's how we indicate what we formally will call fields. Okay, and practically the electromagnetic fields. That are connecting people in wireless communications. Now, these electromagnetic fields are not only good for wireless communications. Wireless, they are important for radars. They are important for sensors. They are important for everything that requires a communication with a distant node for communication with distant node. So before we had the capability to communicate through space, all the communications were wired. So people will throw, even, for example, if you were living on an island, the traditional landlines, as we call them, the landlines, were wires, like a coaxial waveguide, usually the coaxials that we have seen. Those wires would connect and sometimes would throw them in the water. And they had wires, in fact, that were going from the US to Europe through the ocean. And this is how people were communicating before we had satellites that we could use for communication. But now we are outside of the wired world. We have kept it for only optical communications. And everything else is through fields, through electromagnetic waves that move in space. Now, why do we call them waves? Let's assume that I have an antenna. And usually the antennas, we show them like that in electronics. It shows that a wave comes here and then it propagates out like this. All right, in reality, an antenna is propagating isotropically. So what does that mean? Isotropic means that even if here it shows that there is some direction in the radiation, so you can see in fact that there is a direction, primary direction there. If I move very, very far away from an antenna like that, and the antenna eventually becomes a point, usually antennas like this, we say they radiate isotropically. Even if, you know, this is only an approximation. So, because in reality, there is always a preference in direction. And many times we prefer to have a direction because we send all of our power within a given direction. And so we keep the value of the amplitude of this electric field, or the power density, we can keep it high enough. So the higher the power density, the farther away you can go in terms of communicating. But in any case, at this point, there are isotropic antennas. Usually there are the antennas that you want to cover big areas. All right, you don't want to have directivity, as we say. And then in an isotropic antenna, if my antenna is this one, it means that it radiates a field, and the field is going to propagate out like this. But it's going to be the same in every direction. So it's, if I were to show the usually how the field will go out, I will show it like these circles. And these are the circles of the same phase. So you remember that the field is like a wave. It's like a cosine omega t wave. Because this is a harmonic excitation. We have a source like in transmission lines. In transmission lines, we have sources, V of T, to be Vs cosine omega T. All right, that can be a voltage source. Well, a voltage source like this, if we place it at an antenna like this one here, is going to generate an electric field that also, the electric field here, goes, and it's a vector, obviously, because it has a direction. In transmission lines, we do not have direction, because it was the transmission line was going like that. We knew the direction was here. But if you are in free space, along this line, the direction is like this. And along this line, the direction is like this. And along this line, the direction is like this. So the field is not a scalar anymore, but is a vector. And this is an important characteristic when you go from transmission lines here to antennas here. This one is an antenna. And however, when it comes to time variation, this wave looks very similar to these voltages. All right, so if you look at this one and at this one, you see something very similar in terms of, let me do this a little script because eventually we're gonna go to phasors. Okay, so script form implies time variation when it comes to waves. And if you have an electric field, and since we are gonna have an electromagnetic field, then we have also a magnetic field component. All right, and E and H are produced by this antenna. And that's how the field radiates. So then we talked about when we were in transmission lines down here, we talked about these points of equal phase, if you remember. And all these points have a phase of 0 or 360 of n pi, to n pi. To n pi phase. Here, cosine is 1, all right? All of these points down here have also equal phase. And the phase is, in this case, 2n plus 1 pi. And the points at the center here also have the same phase. All of these points are 0, all right? And so forth. The same thing applies to the electromagnetic field. So while the way we represent in transmission lines, the field is like this cosine function. The way we represent in free space the electromagnetic field is through these circles. So the first one is this one. So you could think, for example, I have to be a little more careful when I do this. So you could think of something like this. Something like that, all right? So the points of equal phase will be here, 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 and so forth. So I will do this here. All right, so the points of equal phase, we show them like this. To get an idea of how that looks is if you are in a pond, and you throw, this is a pond, and you throw a small rock, then it looks like this. If you remember, it goes like, that's how the water flows here. All right, it creates those small waves, and those waves expand. So that's how the field goes, which means that if in this transmission line that we've learned, the field along the line practically changes its phase, but the amplitude of this does not change, only because the cosine value changes, but this is constant. And that is in transmission line that goes, it's an infinite long transmission line, so there are no reflections. Then when you have an antenna, the value of this field, E naught, changes as 1/r². Where r square is the distance from the antenna. So this one, r. So it changes E naught. So E naught changes as 1/r². And where do we remember the same variation as 1/r². We remember that in the electric field from a single charge, Q. All right? So the electric field that is generated by an antenna, which is isotropic, meaning it radiates everywhere the same, it changes in terms of the distance from the antenna, the same way that the electric field changes in terms of distance from a charge. The only difference is that it's not only reducing its amplitude by 1/r², but at the same time, it changes its phase as a cosine omega t. So these are now the waves we are talking about, and we call them, we don't call them most of the time electromagnetic fields, we call them electromagnetic waves because of this component, because it looks like this, okay? And looks like a wave. Obviously. Now, if this isotropic antenna is a satellite, all right, which we have here, if this isotropic antenna is this satellite, and we are here on Earth, and we are down on Earth, we are so far from the satellite, okay, so the satellite is here. And we are on the surface of the Earth. Then as the waves coming from the satellite, and we are so far away here, when we look at the wave here, we the distance here, and the distance, if we are two of us, two friends sitting next to each other, these two distances, R1 and R2, are identical almost. So R1 equals R2. So when we are all of us in the classroom, and we are receiving from the same satellite, because that's what happens when you guys take a test, all of the information that comes to you does not come directly from me, it comes from a satellite. So for each one of you plus me, the distance from the satellite is about the same because we are so far from it. And our distances between us are so small compared to the distance that each one of us has from the satellite. So R1 and R2 are the same, which means for the two of us that we are sitting on Earth, or for the many of us, who are sitting on Earth, when this wave comes to us from the satellite, the wave seems to be like this. So the wave seems to be plane, like a plane. The areas of total phase seem to us like planes and not the surfaces of spheres. So that's why we call a wave that is generated by a source that is very far away from us, we call it a plane wave. Okay. Now, with all of this introduction, then we come, which in fact I have here and I will try to put it together for you. We come to what we call the transverse electric magnetic waves, which are nothing else but plane waves. Okay. And for these plane waves, I have some derivations down there that show you what happens and some examples on how these plane waves are reflected or transmitted through surfaces and so forth. And what I would like to do after I check out whether we have a lecture that we can hold on Tuesday, then if we have the opportunity for one more lecture, then I will continue with the lecture we have today. Otherwise, I would have asked you to just keep your notes and remember those notes for those of you who will go to other classes. But at least what I would like you to remember is the sequence of things that we really, how we started in this class and where we went with what we learned. We started from the top and we went down. So all of this information is, it took me a long time, but I thought it was important to be able to put the pieces together so it makes sense to you, because this class is not just a collection of disconnected pieces, but it's rather a pyramid we are trying to develop, to build, so we can eventually claim that we have seen it all. When it comes to how people communicate, we have seen the circuits, we have started with the fundamental forces, with the fields, we have looked at the circuits that we can develop, transmitters and receivers, and finally, the waves that come from antennas. So in any case, this is what I wanted to bring to your attention. It was more of like a discussion, but I think important to put things together so you remember what you've done in this class after you go off to take other classes. In any case, we will have an exercise today. The exercise is going to be on these topics. It's going to be rather a multiple choice, as normally we have, and I'm going to turn it on at 12. It's going to be open between 12 and 6, and then I will see you on Friday, but we also have office hours today from 12 to 2. Please connect if you have any questions. Thank you. See you on Friday.